Okay, today we are going to see how to build a fully decentralized blockchain application using the Horizen Sidechain SDK. So in the Horizen Sidechain SDK, we have implemented most of the needed components to make developers' life easier. But before going on and seeing the details, what is the Sidechain SDK, let's take a step back. Let's start from the need. The need is to build decentralized blockchain applications that are going beyond the cryptocurrency. And what do we mean? Applications that are blockchain applications that are able to use their own set of data and rules. But also they have to be able to use a real coin. And why it is needed? Because in the most of the use cases, you will need to transfer some value. So for example, if you have to sell something, you have to transfer the ownership of something, you have to pay it for it. So it's important that each of these applications has the possibility to transfer some token with a real value. But moreover, a coin with a value is useful to have a real decentralization in the sidechain. And why? Because a blockchain need to reward the actors that are contributing to that blockchain to make it decentralized. For example, if we have a proof of stake blockchain, we need to reward the forgers that are submitting the blocks, because otherwise they will not have the incentive to do it. And so to obtain real decentralization, we need to have a real coin to reward the actors that are joining this network. But obviously, we don't want to bootstrap and launch a new token for each new application because it will require a lot of work. We have to list it on exchange and so on. So it will be a lot inefficient. Okay, but last but not least, we want to keep the Zen blockchain decoupled and independent. So let's see how sidechains solve this problem and what they are. So the sidechains are like applications that are implemented as parallel blockchains with their own logic and data. So all these sidechains can interact with the main chain to transfer the coins. So you can then transfer from the main chain, the Zen blockchain, to a sidechain, some coins. You can imagine to exchange these coins there. And then maybe some user want to have them back in mainchain. I mean, for example, to have it, to send it to an exchange. And it's acceptable that sidechain tracks the mainchain. And for tracking, we mean that are aware on what is happening on the mainchain side. So they can see his network and they can see the blocks. So they can see what is happening there. But obviously, having mainchain tracking sidechain will not be a wise choice because it will not scale. So let's see about the model that we have, Zendoo. So we defined a unique protocol that is used by all the sidechains to transfer the coins. And this is called the Zendoo cross-chain transfer protocol. And the main operation of this protocol are, as we said before, transferring coins from mainchain to sidechains, and we are calling it forward transfers. And then we have another kind of operation that is transferring coins back from sidechain to the mainchain, and this is called backward transfer. In the schema below, you can see sidechain and the mainchain, and the squares represent block, and the arrows represent transfers. You will see a much more detailed schema later in the next slide. So let's go into the details about one kind of transfer, the forward transfer. You can see the forward transfer has a transaction that is included in a main chain block. And it's very similar to the transaction that we are already used to. I mean, the transaction that are currently on our Zen blockchain that are able to spend some mainchain coins, some UTXO. But the difference is that this kind of transaction will have as an output that define the destination sidechain, the user address that will receive these coins in the sidechain and the amount that has been transferred. Okay, once this transaction is included in a mainchain block, the coins are not available anymore in mainchain, they are spent. They're not anymore there. They will be available on the sidechain side, and the user will be able to use them by giving proof of ownership. You remember, one of the data that we have in the output is the user address that can be used on the sidechain side. And as we said before, the sidechains can be aware of these transfers by following the mainchain. So you can have the sidechain, a sidechain forger, forging a sidechain block and including some information on the sidechain block about the transfers that are related to that specific sidechain. Okay, that was quite easy and simple to follow. It's a bit more tricky, and you will see why, the backward transfer. So backward transfer are initiated in the sidechain and then propagated to mainchain on regular intervals. And we call these intervals epochs. So what are epochs? You can see the sidechain life divided into epochs. And you can have withdrawal requests sent by users. So let's say a user has some coins in the sidechain and want to withdraw these coins in the mainchain. So he posts a withdrawal request during an epoch. And at the end of the epoch, these withdrawal requests are collected together and then sent to the mainchain as backward transfers in a certificate. So you can see the certificate as a sort of a collection of backward transfers that reflects the withdrawal request that happened during an epoch. But how mainchain can validate if the certificate is valid, if it doesn't keep track of the sidechain and doesn't know its rules? So it just mainchain node just see this sort of transaction that we call it certificate with these backward transfers that are just the transfers. How can rely on the correctness of this certificate? So this can be easily addressed by using a trusted party that follow the sidechain, knows its rules, and that certify that this backward transfer list followed the sidechain rules. But it's obvious that then this will lead to centralization. So and this and our first goal was to have a decentralized blockchain system. Let's see how we solve this. Okay, Zendoo make use of SNARKs to provide a proof of validity, a succinct proof of validity of the backward transfers that are included in the certificate. Let's go more in detail about this. So you can see the sidechain life has a sort of a set of states that are changing. What do we mean for states? You can see a certain point in the sidechain, of a blockchain in general, and you can associate that point to a state. And you can see the state as the list of UTXOs that are available in that moment. And then you have a transaction that spend some of these UTXO and as output generate some other UTXO. You can then, if you want to modify the state, what do? You apply a transaction that spend a UTXO, remove it, for example, from a tree, and then add to the new, to the tree, the new output. We can call this transition. So if you think that you can have many of these transitions, many of these transactions in an epoch, you can then have many of these proofs that proves the correctness of transition within an epoch. So every time you verify that, for example, that you were spending a UTXO that was really existing at that point, and also you verify that the signature of the transaction was, let me say, the correct signature associated, with the public key defined in the UTXO that you're spending. So you will end up with a lot of proofs. And if you use recursive SNARKs, you can end up with a unique succinct proof that proved all the transitions that happened in that epoch. Okay, but we were talking about backward transfers. We wanna verify that the backward transfer was legitimate. So in reality, we want to verify that the backward transfer spent some existing coins within the epoch. So we want to be sure that the coins were there, and also that the user had the private key to spend that coins. So in reality, with the recursive snarks, we have been able also to prove that the validity of the backward transfers. So if you think also to have the possibility to add a specific snark verification key to each sidechain, you will be able also to prove different kind of rules without having mainchain knowing them. So when you bootstrap a sidechain in the mainchain, when you declare a sidechain in the mainchain, in reality, you specify a snark verification key that will be used by that specific sidechain. And this snark verification key reflects the rules of the sidechain. So what is the result? The sidechain logic is completely decoupled from the mainchain in a totally decentralized way. So no trusted party is involved, and mainchain doesn't know anything about the logic that is implemented on the sidechain side. And so we are allowing any kind of blockchain application. So let's have a look about typical interaction between the mainchain and the sidechain. So we can have, the schema is very similar to the one that we have seen previously. And you have, starting from the left, a forward transfer that happened on the mainchain. So some user sending some coins in the sidechain. Let's say that this forward transfer has been synchronized. I will not go into details about this in a sidechain block. And then you will have, you can see this arrow. So some custom transaction is happening in the sidechain. So this forward transfer is spent by the owner and sent to someone else in the sidechain. And then maybe this user is going to post a withdrawal request. The withdrawal requests are then collected in a certificate at the end of withdrawal epoch one. And then the certificate is sent to mainchain and synced within a mainchain block. And then the user will have his coins available to be spent. Okay, now let's go back to the sidechain SDK. Okay, what does implement our sidechain SDK? The sidechain SDK already implements the Zendoo protocol. So all the things that we have described are already implemented in Zendoo protocol, in the sidechain SDK. So you don't have to take care about how to make a forward transfer and so on. Everything is already implemented, even the synchronization of information between the mainchain and the sidechain and so on. But also, the sidechain SDK is almost a full node implementation. So implements all the typical node functionalities like consensus. We already implemented a consensus that is a proof of stake consensus. It's a modified version of Ouroboros Prowse that is able also to manage this cross-chain interaction. There is already implemented a network layer. Obviously, messages between nodes can be exchanged there, and this is already implemented. Blocks and whatever are already sent for the network. Transactions. So the SDK already provide the classes that allows you to perform the basic transaction, like, for example, exchanging coins between users. But also wallet operations. So there are already all the wallet operations that are needed, for example, to know your balance or to manage your keys or to post a transaction. So these are already implemented in the sidechain SDK, but there is a lot more. Okay, to see the development path of an application, we want to use the Lambda registry as an example. And now we are going to see what is the Lambda registry. Okay, the Lambda registry is a sidechain, is an example sidechain that allows users to exchange the ownership of cars. So a user that owns a car on the sidechain will be able to put the car on sale, and then you will have another user that finalized the purchase. So you will see that there are different kind of transactions. But before going there, let's see how a car is represented. So you can see the car as a sort of a UTXO. In the Scottish terminology, this is called box. And the SDK is based on the Scorex framework. So let's call it a card box. So you can see the card box as a sort of a container of the data of the car. So the color, the model, the vehicle identification number, and the owner. And for owner, we mean, for example, the public key of the owner. Okay, let's see how the car can be put on sale. We can have a transaction that is somehow changing the state of this card box, is spending this card box and create a new box that we can call car sell order box. It's a sort of a representation of a car that is on sale, that will have this car on sale, will have the car information, but moreover, the sale information. So for example, the price and expected buyer. So we have a transaction that is spending a car box that will not be anymore in the state, but we will have a car sell order box in the state. And okay, let's see another example about boxes. How coins, how Zen are represented on the sidechain side. We already provide a box implementation that represents Zen. And this is we call it regular box. And in reality it has the typical information of a UTXO. So the quantity, the value, the amount of Zen, and the public key of the owner. So let's see what could be a typical interaction in the Lambo registry. Okay, let's start from the top left and you will see something strange. A user array declares a car. Obviously this is an example. So we allow anybody to have his own new Lambo. So you can declare your own Lambo by just posting a transaction and having a new car box declared. So user array is declaring a new car. And then you can see that user B sends some coins with a forward transfer to the sidechain. So this transaction is then synced on the sidechain side, and then these coins are available there. But then the user array decides to sell his new Lambo and creates a sell transaction for user B. So specifying in the car sell order box, the public key of user B and obviously the price. And so then we have user B that creates a buy transaction that matches the sell transaction, pays for it. So the user B spends some of his coins, so spends the regular box, and in output we'll have the payment box, the regular box that is sending the amount to user A. And moreover, one of the output of this transaction will be the car box that is transferring the ownership to himself, and he will spend also the car sell order box. So at that point, the car sell order box is not existing anymore. The user array received the regular box with the coins, and the user B will have a car box with the address that is owned by himself. Then user array can decide to create a withdrawal request for withdrawing the coins that he just received. And then at the end of the epoch, you'll see the certificate that is created, and the user array will have finally his coins in mainchain.
Alberto, this was great. So does it? Does this mean that I can declare my own Lambo and just pay fees?
Many of them. As many as you want.
That sounds profitable. Okay, now let's deep dive into the code.